For those of you brothers and sisters who want to make a donation for my video making efforts, you can donate to me on Cash App or Patreon. With that being said, as usual, please subscribe, like the videos. Let's get straight into it. Shalom, people, shalom. So I happened to catch this little news segment here about Russian icons, and I said to myself, you know what? This will make a perfect backdrop for a video. So with that being said, brothers, pay attention to all the icons in the background, and also pay attention to the narrator and the excuse and narrative he uses to explain why the icons have a darker complexion.
Icons dating back to the 14th century brought together from private collections across Russia.
It's very beautiful. It gives you goose pimples. It's a remarkable exhibition.
It's an exhibition which feeds the senses. Everything is so grey outside at the moment, and here suddenly it's a feast for the eyes.
And it's a feast that marks 100 years since religious icons started to be recognised as works of art. Before then, they were mainly viewed as religious objects, often left blackened over the centuries by the passage of time and...
So I hope you brothers caught that. Now you see the excuse or the narrative that the narrator had to come up with to try to explain off why these icons have a dark complexion. He just stated they blackened over the centuries by the passage of time. Never underestimate the lengths that these people will go to eradicate so-called black people from history. The reason why these icons are blackened, as the narrator would put it, is because these icons are depicting so-called black people. These icons were created by so-called black people, and the people during those time periods were so-called black people. It's not that complex. So let's continue.
Added layers of paint.
When we learned how to remove the dark layers, we discovered underneath an overwhelming beauty, to such an extent that it shocked André Matisse, who was in Moscow at the time. He said, it's here that artists should come to learn to paint, not to Italy.
But today, only a small number of these masterpieces remain. Most were destroyed during the Soviet era.
These icons are the survivors. If museums hadn't saved them, they wouldn't exist today. There are 50,000 icons in Russian museums. Before, there were millions.
But now the future of this part of Russian heritage is up for debate. Are the icons best?
So brothers, sticking with the narrative, it blackened over time, as the narrator kindly put it. Pay attention to this freeze frame here, so follow my mouse, brothers. Look at all of these parts and on the outline. Why is this still white? The lady's headdress is still white. The garments on this child is still white. In the middle of this dude's robes, still white. Right here is still white. Right here, still white. Right here. And around this lady's head, the halo is still white. It's funny that the blackened effect only seems to be on the parts where it shows their skin complexion, like their face, their hands, and their arms. It's funny how that works out, isn't it, brothers? Never ever underestimate the lengths, the fabrications that these people will go to eradicate you and inject themselves into history. And you see, this is what real culture vulture is. A lot of so-called black people think that culture vulture is like rap, hip-hop, dance, so on and so forth. When it comes to those type of things, that is just like the salt, the seasoning, the herbs, the spices, the flavors that the Most High gave us. What real culture is the laws that you follow, your customs, the way that you dress, your code of conduct, your national flag, the deity that you worship, so on and so forth, not rap, hip-hop, dance. But you see, so-called black people only know that because they've always been taught that their history is slavery, so they don't really have any culture. So they latch on to those type of trivial things. And the ultimate form of culture vulture that has happened to our people is a certain head tribe that likes to wear hats that are a bit small for their heads, claiming to be the people of the Bible. That is the ultimate form of culture vulture that has happened to our people. not rap, hip-hop, and dance. And you have to understand, when it comes to rap and hip-hop, so-called black people do not limit our people to rap and hip-hop, because all forms of music was created by so-called black people. So you hear simple-minded black people say things, oh, you like white people music. Now, what are they saying? Basically, they're saying white people music is like things like opera and classical. Those were all started by so-called black people. You know, people like Mozart, Beethoven, yes, who, by the way, were so-called black. But anyways, not to get off topic, back to this freeze frame on his portrait. Brothers, you know what they're going to say? Because I know how these people operate. They're going to say the reason why the blackening effect only seems to affect their skin complexion is because the painter used a different type of chemical solution to paint their faces, and that type of chemical solution that painter uses gets dark over time. I already know how these people operate. Oh, and let me tackle another thing. I've seen some of you guys in the comment section saying, oh, well, they may be dark, but they have white man features or Caucasian features. Because you see the small lips and the skin thin noses. First and foremost, there's no such thing as Caucasian features. And the reason why I say that is because the Caucasian is not the original man. Secondly, when it comes to a lot of these icons, the reason why they have like the thin skinny noses is it's because it's the style of the icons. That's how they were depicted and painted. But more on that later. So now we are going to analyze some of the icons. So sticking with the narrative of white man features, this icon I think is depicting the prophet Elijah, but that's either here nor there. As you can see from the icon, brothers, this is clearly depicting a so-called black man. There's no getting around this one. But as you can see from the features, you can see the very thin, skinny nose and the small lips. Now, are you going to tell me that these are white man features? And I don't think you guys are realizing what you are doing when you make assessments and assertions like that. You know, you see these icons and you say to yourself, well, I can clearly see that this icon is depicting a so-called black man, but look at his features. He has small lips and he has a very thin skinny nose. Those are white people features. You know what? Maybe KMZ doesn't know what he's talking about, and these icons did get dark over time. I'ma say it once, I'ma say it again. The reason why a lot of these Russian / Byzantine icons have the small lips and the very thin, skinny noses, it's because it was the art style of the icons, not because they're depicting white man features. That is it. It's not that complicated, brothers and sisters. And I'm gonna show you more examples of the small lips and the very thin skinny noses in order to beat it into your heads. But before we do that, another thing that some of you guys probably don't realize what you are doing, you are falling for the Caucasian man's pseudoscience, his Caucasoid, his Mongoloid, and his Negroid theory. So what does that mean? Basically, what you are doing, you are pigeonholing dark races of people to only having broad faces, broad noses, and big lips. In other words, if they don't have those features, they're not so-called black. And you can't view history through that understanding. Do not limit so-called black people into the category Negroid only. And when I say so-called black people in this context, I'm not necessarily just talking about the Israelites. I'm talking about the other dark races of people also, the original man and woman who were melanated. So what does that mean? So-called black people, different dark races of people, the original man, the original woman, are gonna come in all forms, shapes, sizes, and all types of phenotypes. So don't let their pseudoscience limit your understanding. But going on the Caucasoid, Mongoloid, and Negroid narrative and how they use it to inject themselves into history. For example, when it comes to Ham, Shem, and Japheth, they're going to tell you that all so-called black people come from Hamites. They're going to say that like the Japanese, the Chinese, and the Mongoloids all come from Japheth. And they're going to say that the modern-day Turkic people and like the Caucasians, basically, they are akin to one of another, that they come from Shem. And this is the understanding that some of you guys have. This is why you're confused about history. Now, when it comes to like the big noses and the big lips and the broad face, is that a defining characteristic that so-called black people have? Absolutely. That's how we identify some of the statues. But that's my point. Don't limit so-called black people to only that type of category. So just to summarize everything, the reason why these icons have the small lips and the thin nose is because it was the style of the icons. Do not view black history through the Caucasoid, Mongoloid and Negroid lens. But I would like to add, I'm still going to use terms like African American, black people, and I'm still going to use terms like Caucasoid, Mongoloid and Negroid in order to explain my points, especially to the new viewers. So now this is an icon of Yahawashi, alleged Yahawashi. Now the reason why I say alleged is because when our people were creating a lot of these icons, they were bugged out. You can just be looking at the divine child Tammuz, which was an offspring of Semiramis and Nimrod. But they're just going to tell you that it's the Messiah. But that's either here nor there. As you can see from the icon, brothers, you can see the brown, dark skin and the afro. So there's no getting around that this is a black youth. But take a look at the features. As you can see, once again, the small lips and the very thin, skinny nose. So are you going to still say that it's white man features? Here's an icon of King David, presented with the dark skin complexion, the woolly hair texture. But as you can see, brothers, once again, the small lips and the very thin, skinny nose. Here's an icon of Saint Cyprian, who was the Bishop of Carthage. And as you can see, the dark skin, the afro, the small lips, and the very thin, skinny nose. Here's another icon, dark skin, small lips, thin nose. Here's an icon of Abraham, his sons, and the penitent thief. As you can see, they're all so-called black. There's no getting around this one. But look at the art style once more. The small lips and a very thin, skinny nose. So here are three icons from the catacombs. To the left is King David. In the middle is Moses. And to the right is King Solomon. All so-called black men. But as you can see from their features, the small lips and the slim, thin nose. Are you guys starting to see the pattern now? It's almost as if it was the art style of these icons, but some of you still may not get it, so let's continue. Here's an icon of Christ and the Most High, but I just want to reiterate, brothers, sisters, if you manage to get your hands on some of these icons, do not put them up on your wall and pray over them. I'm just using these as a backdrop. But as you can see, the thin skinny nose, and the small lips once again. Another icon of Christ and the Most High. And look at their thin, long noses. So now, brothers, this is an icon of the 40 martyrs of Sebaste. And just for entertainment purposes, I would love to hear what kind of story or narrative that they can concoct to try and explain away why all these men are so-called black. And as you can see, they all have their shirts off, revealing their dark skin complexion. But that's either here nor there. As you can see from their features once again, you see the small lips and the thin noses. An icon of the hospitality of Abraham. You see those long, thin noses. An icon who I don't have the identity of, but it's still a great backdrop. As you can see, the dark skin and the long, thin nose. So this is a book called Russian Icons by Swinefall Philip, which you can find on archive.org. We are in page 22 and we are viewing an icon called the Ascension. So what we're going to do, we're going to skip down to the second paragraph because it details what we are viewing. So the Ascension icon derives by way of a Byzantine model. from a primitive Palestinian type, the difference being that the Virgin, symbolizing in the midst of the apostles, the church which abides on earth, is also represented in the gesture of prayer with outstretched hands. The head, however, is not given full face, but is turned to the side. Further, the Russian artist introduces a decorative motif in the rugged rocks which form the background, in which his delight in the primitive expressiveness of linear ornament can be felt in the two angels. He has the opportunity of setting off the beautiful white of classical painting in contrast to the sonorous group of the apostles, the crimson of the Virgin, and red with which she is shod. So as you can see from the icon, brothers, you see the angels in their white garments. So ask yourself the question once again, how come their garments didn't get dark over time? If we are going on the narrative, it blackened over time, shouldn't their garments be the same pigmentation as their skin complexion? But as you can see in this icon, they all have those thin noses once again. So now, brothers, to the left is the Apostle Nicanor, in the middle is the Prophet Nahum, and to the right is the Apostle John. What do they all have in common? That dark skin complexion and that long, thin nose. If you guys still do not understand that these features were just the stylized art that these icons were depicted in, I don't know what to tell you. If you don't get it, you don't get it. So now we are going to tackle the Black Madonna. Some of you may know this or have been taught that this is the Virgin Mary and baby Jesus. First and foremost, this is not the Virgin Mary and baby Jesus. This is the Mother Goddess and her divine child, aka Semiramis and Tammuz. And even if this was an image or a statue of the Virgin Mary and baby Jesus, you're not supposed to be bowing down and worshipping idols regardless. But anytime you see a statue of an image of the mother or a woman holding her child like this, this is a representation of Semiramis and Tammuz. An excellent book that you guys can get is a book called The Two Babylons by Alexander Hyssop, and it goes into detail of where all these religions come from and how they all go back to Semiramis, Nimrod, and Tammuz. So Hyssop asserts that Semiramis was a queen consort and the mother of Nimrod, builder of the Bible's Tower of Babel. He said that Semiramis and Nimrod incestuous male offspring was the Akkadian deity Tammuz, and that all divine pairings in religions were retellings of this story. How is Tammuz related to Nimrod? As the sun god, Nimrod used his sun rays to miraculously inseminate Semiramis with a child. This child was thus considered to be divinely conceived. The child's name was Tammuz, which she claimed was the reincarnated Nimrod. Thus, Semiramis was both Nimrod's wife and mother. Semiramis claimed that after Nimrod had died, he ascended to the sun and became the sun god himself. She then told the people that her son, Tammuz, was the reincarnation of the sun god Nimrod, and that she had been impregnated by the rays of the sun. Tammuz was conceived before Nimrod died, or as some versions state, she conceiving through an extra marital source. She would later marry her son Tammuz, who was in fact Nimrod reincarnated, and this is where you get the virgin birth and the Trinity doctrine from. Brothers, sisters, Mary did not get impregnated by the Holy Spirit. Mary and Joseph had intercourse which produced Christ/Yahawashi. Yahawashi entered this earth like we all did, through the seed. Both of our parents had intercourse, which produced an offspring. That virgin birth goes back to Semiramis, Tammuz, and Nimrod. Nimrod, the sun god, impregnated Semiramis through his sun rays, which produced a divine child. And what I've noticed, that doctrine also trips up a lot of the Old Testament only dudes, because they use that as validation to deny Yahawashi. So they say things like, you see, quote unquote, Jesus is the sun god, Jesus is Osiris, Jesus is Nimrod, Jesus is Tammuz. Well, technically, yeah. Jesus, that's Cesare Borgia, not Yahawashi. They're completely different. This is why I say religion has nothing to do with the Bible. That Babylonian doctrine has been spliced in with the Bible, which has caused major confusion. For those of you brothers and sisters who still believe in the virgin birth and the Holy Trinity doctrine, I highly suggest and advise you guys go watch this brother right here, Tribe of Judah Teach, and watch his video on the virgin birth. Also, his video on the Trinity doctrine is false. Once again, that is Tribe of Judah Teach. Brother does excellent breakdowns. So sticking with the Black Madonna, now we're going to read an article that was posted by the brother Johnny on the Discord, and this article goes into detail on the fables, lies, and narratives they try to tell to explain off why the Black Madonna is so-called black. So the title, it reads, Taking a Magnifying Glass to the Brown Faces in Medieval Art. The Tumblr sounds a bit like a college course, People of Color in European Art History, and its goal is pretty ambitious. The blog's author, Melissa DeWolfe, says that her goal is to challenge the common perception that pre-Enlightenment Europe was all white, which she argues is a much more recent and deliberate invention. All too often, these works go unseen in museums, art history classes, online galleries, and other venues because of retroactive whitewashing of medieval Europe, Scandinavia, and Asia, she writes. This blog is here to emphasize the modern racism that retroactively erases gigantic swaths of truth and beauty. And she means erased literally. While it was once the convention to depict one of the Magi, the fabled three wise men of the Christian folklore, as a dark-skinned black man, many dark-skinned people who appear in portraits of European royals were later painted white or simply cropped out when they were reproduced in textbooks. So I'm gonna read those last two lines once more. Many dark-skinned people who appear in portraits of European royals were later painted white or simply cropped out when they were reproduced in textbooks, and that's exactly what happened. Pamela Patton, a professor of art history who focuses on Iberia, says that artists from the Middle Ages seems clearly interested in representing a diversity of ethnic variations, including different skin colors, hair textures, and facial features. She goes on, it's tempting to ask whether they were primed for this by the actual ethnic diversity of the medieval Iberian world, where there were Africans, Arabs, Jews, and other non-European groups in some numbers, she says. For DeWolt, the blog is a chance to share findings from her personal research and a way to compare notes with art scholars and aficionados. It's very common for me to post work of art and then to have someone from medieval literature add information from that discipline, and then to have someone from military history add some context from their discipline, she says. And there are a lot of folks interested in this. Mark Rosen, an art historian at the University of Texas, says there's been a flowering of academic interest on race in European art. There's actually been a great deal of recent scholarship on the topic, especially in the years after 1500, he says. That's when European countries began exploring Spain. That's when European countries began exploring and Spain expelled its black African population, which settled elsewhere on the continent. Now, the way that's written or the way he explains it, it's like he's saying that the Caucasian was in rulership and they did have a black population in Spain, but they expelled them as if they all weren't so-called black. And you see, they keep on the narrative that black equals African and African equals black. So that means European equals white, which it does not. European also equals so-called black. They were all so-called black. But history and race are always contested spaces. Art history is no different. Many scholars suggest that the black Madonnas were meant to be black, but were actually depicting virgins who were sunburnt. You see how desperate these people are getting? Let's run that back. Many scholars suggest that the black Madonnas were meant to be black, but were actually depicting virgins who were sunburnt. As I always state, never underestimate the lies, the narratives, and fables that these people will go to eradicate you and inject themselves into history. The reason why the black Madonnas are so-called black is because it's depicting a black woman and a black child. It's that simple, not because they were sunburnt. And people will believe this, you know. That's the crazy thing about it, including our people. And this sunburn also goes into that tanned narrative. In my whitewashing of history video on Joan of Arc, a commenter commented stating the reason why Joan of Arc in historical documentation was described as black, dark or brown, it's because she was out in the sun too long. Brothers, sisters, don't be so inquisitive to why these people say the things that they do. You have to understand how these people have been taught history. They have been taught that they are the original people, that all civilizations were started and pioneered by them, that they are the great teachers, inventors, scholars, philosophers, archaeologists, historians, so on and so forth. They have the highest IQ. When you go to a public school system, everybody of renown in history is always white. And what were so-called black people? All so-called black people ever were slaves unto them. And if you were them, why would you want to learn any history from the racial aspect that is different from that? Their whole history is based on lies, manipulation, deceit, fabrications, and subterfuge. Brothers, sisters, do not go back and forth with these people. If you're going to check them for the stupid comments that they make, leave your comments to a maximum of one or two. Don't write whole novels, essays, and paragraphs going back and forth with them and trying to educate these people. Spend that energy teaching our people their true history. These people will always be irrelevant. But anyways, let's get back to the article. Many scholars suggest that the black Madonnas were meant to be black, but were actually depicting virgins who were sunburnt. On DeWalt's blog, she highlighted a discussion in which a commenter suggested that figures with dark skin in certain plasters and portraits were dark only because of how the dyes used in them had aged over the centuries. And there goes that it got dark over time narrative. It got burned by chimney smoke. It got burned by incense smoke. It got burned by soot. But you see, even before I read this article, I stated I know how these people operate. When it comes to the icons, they're going to tell you the reason why the parts on the icons, the skin complexion, that's the only part that is black. They're going to tell you the reason why their skin complexion is dark. It's because they use some type of different chemical solution or paint to paint those areas. And that chemical solution or paint, that's the type of paint or solution that gets dark over time. And here in this article, that's exactly what they're going with. These people are so easy to predict. But anyways, others suggest that DeWalt's blog was an attempt to advance a multicultural agenda, and that's also another new thing also. They're going to say, or they're going to use, for example, when you see a lot of these movies and TV shows now, especially in the Middle Ages, they feature a lot of so-called black people, or they have black people sprinkled in them, and they're going to say that's some kind of leftist agenda, when they're actually just putting the truth in the TV series. So the Tumblr page, People of Color in European Art History. retroactive erasure, the Black Madonnas of Europe. One of the most baffling failures of logic in all of academia is the flagrant attachment to the unsupported claim that the Black Virgins of Europe, of which there are well over 300, are not Black because they are Black. For some reason, their inability to explain her dark complexion is combined with the adamant position that it must be explained. That, however, has not stopped most scholars on the subject of the Black Madonnas, asserting that whatever the reason for her skin color, it could not possibly be because the artist intended to paint her skin that color. And if they did, it must be some other reason than because that was how she looked. This Madonna in Tindari, Sicily, dates from well before the 8th century, and the Latin inscription reads literally, "I am Black." Unfortunately, that does not seem to be a message art historians want to hear. There was very little academic interest in the supposed anomaly of the Black Madonnas of Europe until relatively recently. Most art historians, if they mentioned them at all, attributed her complexion to age, accumulation of smoke and other environmental factors. And yes, as we all know, that goes back into the "it got dark over time" narrative. So in fact, the evidence shows that this is false, despite the fact that no other portion of the paintings or statues had been affected by the same darkening. And that's the exact same thing that I always say when it comes to a lot of the frescoes or icons. How come the darkening effect didn't only affected their hands, their face and their feet, all the parts where it shows their skin complexion, but the darkening effect didn't affect anywhere else on the icon? It's funny how this darkening effect is very selective, isn't it, people? So anyways, or why, when the images were restored, copied, or repainted in subsequent centuries, the original brown or black skin color was painstakingly preserved. Even analysis of relative age, possible smoke exposure, and darkness of skin tone debunk these assumptions. Many of these copies, and even copies of copies, are made from originals attributed to Saint Luke and are said to have been drawn from life, i.e. they are true portraits of the Virgin Mary herself. Nearly all of these images that have been painted over show the Holy Mother and Christ child with dark brown or black faces and hands. A wide variety of images that have been attributed at some point. I don't know why I'm having difficulty saying the word attributed. Attributed. So attributed at some point. Although some have been shown to have other origins more recently. To Saint Luke can be viewed here, including ones that have been painted over or literally whitened in the 18th and 19th centuries. It's funny how those dates always come up, isn't it, brothers? Because this was the time period where the Caucasian was starting to rise and Black rulership was starting to fall, especially from the mid 1800s. One of the factors that art historians have pointed to repeatedly as evidence that these images were not intended to be Black, were not intended to be of a Black woman, is that there is no mention of them in historical documents being described as Black. However, there is no reason to suppose that the way she was perceived at the time these images were made, or for centuries afterwards, is the same as they are viewed retroactively, that her skin color would have been seen as anomalous. Unlike the historians of this century, these texts describe only clothing and decoration or mention the image of Our Lady without provocation upon relative skin hue or provocation. In quite notable opposition to those who are adamant that these images do nothing to suggest that the Virgin Mary was a dark-skinned woman, the 15th century scholar Gabriel de Barletta quotes the 13th century Saint Albert the Great. According to him, you ask, was the Virgin dark or fair? Albertus Magnus says that she was not simply dark, nor simply red-headed or red-haired, nor just fair-haired. Mary was a blend of complexions, partaking of all of them, because a face partaking of all of them is a beautiful one. And yet this says Albertus, we must admit she was a little on the dark side. There are three reasons for thinking this. Firstly, by reason of complexion, since Jews tend to be dark and she was a Jewess. Secondly, by reason of witnesses, since St. Luke made the three pictures of her now at Rome, Loreto and Bologna, and these are brown complexioned. Thirdly, by reason of affinity, our son commonly takes after his mother and vice versa. Christ was dark. Therefore, it is also notable that according to Albertus, the dark skin of Christ is a well-known fact and is used to demonstrate that by virtue of heredity, it follows that Mary herself would also be dark-complected. When this in contrast with some of the more absurd claims passed as explanations of the Holy Mother's dark skin, including Ian Begg's ludicrous, Mary lived in a hot climate and would have been very sunburnt. So you hear that, people? The reason why she is dark, she was out in the sun too long. So whenever you brothers and sisters read historical documentation of anybody in history described as swarthy, tawny, black, dark, brown, it's because they were just out in the sun too long. It's that simple. And as you can see, all these images of the Virgin Mary are very dark. So she must have been out in the sun for a very, 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 very long time to get her dark complexion. Because it makes sense, right? It illuminates just how far many writers on the Black Madonnas are willing to stretch credulity. Begg's willingness to point out the open hostility that any scholarship on the Black Virgins was met with in the 20th century is made hypocritical by omission of any reasons why every single priest and nun would have walked out of the room at the 1952 American Association for Advancement of Science, namely racial prejudice that did not exist at these times that these images were made, or at the time that they were renowned and venerated. In fact, denigration towards the appearance of the Black Virgins is a modern invention. Before the 18th century, they were seen as not only the most true to life due to their origins attributed to St. Luke's portraits, but also the most beautiful and desirable. It was not until later that the qualification Negro Sum Sed Formosa, I am black but beautiful, was added to several French Black Madonna statues, including one in Notre Dame. So I'm just going to stop it there. Basically, this just sums up. They just make things up to explain why the icons, images, so on and so forth are depicting so-called black people, and this one is just focused on the Black Madonna. And as you can see, it's always in the mid-1800s, 18th century. You're going to see all of these narratives form. And another thing, whenever you see a lot of these low-level Caucasians in the comment section or on these forums say the most stupid things, they actually get all of that from the historians, scientists, archaeologists, and writers. And basically, they give themselves credibility to lie. For example, you know, you might say to yourself, KMZ, what do you know? It doesn't matter that you show historical documentation. It doesn't matter that you show artifacts, relics, sculptures, monuments, statues. That doesn't matter. You didn't go to Harvard. You didn't go to Yale. Do you have a PhD, KMZ? And unfortunately, some of our people also think that way. You have to have like a high degree of education and not just critical thought, or just view things with your eyes. So now we are going to take a look at some famous historical Russians / Eastern Europeans. So we're going to kick off with this brother here. Now this brother is Fyodor, or Fyodor, as I think it's correctly pronounced in Russian, but I'm going to go with Fyodor because it's easier for me to pronounce. So Fyodor the First was Tsar of Russia. And he was crowned in 1584 after the death of his father. And his father is none other than Ivan the Terrible. So Fyodor was born in Moscow, the son of Ivan IV / Ivan the Terrible, by his first wife Anastasia Romanova. Although he was the sixth and youngest child of his mother, he grew up with only one older brother, Ivan, because all his other older siblings died before Fyodor was 1 year old. His mother also died by the time Fyodor was 3 years old, and her death greatly affected his father, who had been very attached to his wife. Ivan IV began to earn his nickname, the Terrible, during the years of Fyodor's childhood. He also took a series of other wives, but Fyodor's only surviving half-sibling was Dmitri of Uglich. Now, since Dmitri of Uglich was mentioned, let's get his icon. So this is the icon of Prince Dmitri of Russia, the younger brother of Fyodor I of Russia. And this icon is found at the Solovetsky Monastery. So speaking about Ivan the Terrible, the father of Dmitri and Fyodor, some of you may know this tourist attraction. This is St. Basil's Cathedral in Moscow, and this was built or commissioned by Ivan the Terrible. The Cathedral of Vasily the Blessed, commonly known as St. Basil's Cathedral, is an Orthodox church in Red Square of Moscow and is one of the most popular cultural symbols of Russia. The building, now a museum, is officially known as the Cathedral of the Intercession of the Most Holy Theotokos. Now, for those who don't know, Theotokos is a title given to the Virgin Mary. It was built from 1555 to 1561 under orders from Ivan the Terrible. So where does the St. Basil name come from? It comes from this dude here. This is an icon of St. Basil, and he was a Russian Orthodox saint. He was also known as Basil the Blessed, Basil Fool for Christ, or Basil the Wonder Worker of Moscow. And as you can see in his icon, he's in the nude, and there's a reason for that. St. Basil, originally an apprentice shoemaker, he went to Moscow when he was 16. There, he helped those who were ashamed to ask for alms, but were in need of help. He adopted an eccentric lifestyle of shoplifting and giving to the poor to shame the miserly. Now, for those who don't know, miserly people are people who don't like to spend a lot of money, to the point where they forgo basic essentials and they hoard a lot of possessions and money. so and help those in need. He went naked and weighed himself down with chains. So this is why when you search up icons of Saint Basil, he's always going to be in the nude. He rebuked Ivan the Terrible for not paying attention in church. Basil were said to have the gift of prophecy. When he died on August the 2nd, 1552 or 1557, Saint Macarius, Metropolitan of Moscow, served his funeral with many clergy. He is buried in St. Basil's Cathedral in Moscow, which was commissioned by Ivan for commemoration of his conquest of Kazan, and was named for the saint later. Basil was formally canonized in 1588. So here is another icon of Saint Basil, and as you can see, the incense smoke darkened their skin complexion. Now don't ask me why the incense smoke didn't seem to darken the background, which is white, or darken the robes on the dude on the right, because as you can see, his robes are still white. Don't ask me why the incense smoke is so selective. What do I know? I don't have a PhD. So now this is a portrait of Vladimir the First / Vladimir the Great and his two sons, Boris and Gleb. Now Vladimir the Great was Prince of Novgorod, Grand Prince of Kiev, and ruler of Kievan Rus from 980 till 1015. And let me reiterate, if I mention things in this video like Rus, Norsemen, Vikings, locations like Poland, Czechoslovakia, Estonia, Hungary, Latvia, Romania, Russia, Finland, Norway, Poland, Slovenia, understand I'm talking about people and locations that were ruled over by so-called black people. These people were not pale, blonde-haired, blue-eyed people like they're going to show you on your mainstream media TV networks. They have taken so-called black people's history and claimed it as their own, and have provided you thus far in this video of all the icons proving that these people were so-called black. So here is another icon of Vladimir and his two sons. Antique icon of Saint Prince Vladimir and the first glorified Russian saint Boris and Gleb, painted in the early 16th century. This whole image of Vladimir the Great, Grand Prince of Kiev, and his sons, the first Russian saints, Boris and Gleb, symbolically links the exhibition with Kievan Rus' conversion to Orthodox Christianity, occurred in 988 by order of Prince Vladimir. So some of you brothers already may know this, but for those who don't, this is a portrait of Peter the Great of Russia, housed in St. Petersburg, which was named after Peter the Great, in the State Hermitage Museum. So even though we can see the portrait of Peter the Great, we're going to read a reference from a book called A General Collection of Voyages and Travels by J. Pinkerton of his complexion. So Peter the Great of Russia is also described as having black eyes and hair with a swarthy complexion. So speaking of Peter the Great, this is Abram Petrovich Ganibal, who was a Russian nobleman, Russian military engineer, major general, and he became a prominent member of the imperial court in the reign of Peter the Great's daughter, Elizabeth. Now what they're going to tell you is that Abraham, he was kidnapped from Africa and he was presented as a gift to Peter the Great. And what I like to call this is the rags to riches slave narrative. So what do I mean by this? Basically, whenever these people cannot lie about a historical figure of nobility that was so-called black, they have to make sure they attach a slave background to this historical figure. I'm gonna give you guys an example. I'm going to concoct a narrative or a story out of thin air. Let's just say there was a famous English painter who was so-called black and he was of nobility and they couldn't lie about his history or his identity. They are going to concoct a story like this, that this English painter, this black English painter of nobility, in his youth, he came from Africa as a slave, but he was a very good painter. Now, he was such a good painter that he caught the attention of the king. And the king liked his painting so much that he became the personal painter of the king. And because he was the personal painter of the king showered him with gifts and gave him a noble title. And this is why this African slave became English nobility. These are the type of stories that the historians and scholars are going to come up with. They always have to make sure they attach the slave narrative to any historical figure that was so-called black. This is the seal of Simon the First of Bulgaria, or Simon the Great, and he ruled over Bulgaria from 893 till 927. Now, during his rule, his territory spread between the Aegean, the Adriatic, and the Black Sea. He also led a lot of successful campaigns against the Byzantines, Hungary, and Serbs, which led to Bulgaria's greatest territorial expansion. This is the son of Simon the Great, Peter the First of Bulgaria, and he was emperor from May 927 till 969. So this is Emperor Samuel of Bulgaria, and as you can see from this bust, this is a facial reconstruction based on his remains. Now, Samuel was co-ruler with Roman the First of Bulgaria, and Roman the First of Bulgaria, his father was Peter the First of Bulgaria. Now, that's the portrait or the icon that we just saw previous. He co-ruled with his son, and they had constant warfare against the Byzantine Empire, and the ruler of the Byzantine Empire in their time period was Basil, however you want to pronounce it, the second. So, speaking about Byzantine Emperor Basil the Second, this is a coin with him and his brother Constantine the Eighth. Now, to the left is Basil II, and on the right is Constantine the Eighth. So, speaking of Constantine the Eighth, the brother of Basil II, these are his two daughters, empresses Zoe and Theodora. So Zoe was born when her father, Constantine, was nominal co-emperor to his brother, Basil II. Basil died in 1025 when Zoe was 47. Now, before we continue, I want to show you guys an illustrated manuscript of Basil II. So this is an illustrated manuscript of Basil II being crowned. And even though they've tried to whitenize this image, you can still see that all of these men are so-called black. Now, I just want to remind you guys, whenever you see that dark smudge, grayish color to the pigmentation on illustrated manuscripts like this, they've tried to whitenize the image by using things like Tipex or some type of chemical solution. But going on the narrative, it got dark over time. Why is the background still white? Look at the dude that is crowning Basil II. Look at his garments. As you can see on his neck area, on his shoulders, that part is still white, and on his legs is still white. And the people behind him, their garments are very same. How come those parts didn't get dark over time, and the darkening effect is just once again is on their skin complexion. So Zoe was born when her father Constantine was nominal co-emperor to his brother Basil II. Basil died in 1025 when Zoe was 47. Her father ascended the Byzantine throne as Constantine VIII. As he had no sons, Constantine hoped to continue the dynasty by marrying off one of his daughters. Zoe, aged 50, was married to Romanos Argyros. They took the throne the next day on her father's death. So speaking about Romanos, Zoe's husband, let's get him. So this is the coin of Romanos III. Romanos was Byzantine emperor from 1028 until his death. He was a Byzantine noble and senior official in Constantinople when the dying Constantine VIII forced him to divorce his wife and marry the emperor's daughter, Zoe. Upon Constantine's death, 3 days later, Romanos took to the throne. Romanos has been recorded as a well-meaning but inefficient emperor. He disorganized the tax system and undermined the military, personally leading a disastrous military expedition against Aleppo. He fell out with his wife and foiled several attempts on his throne, including two which revolved around his sister-in-law, Theodora. He spent large amounts on the construction and repair of churches and monasteries. He died after 6 years on the throne, allegedly murdered, and was succeeded by his wife's young lover, Michael IV. Now just a bit of background on Michael IV. He worked at court and he caught the eye of Empress Zoe, and behind the scenes, allegedly, they had an affair, and it was believed that both Zoe and Michael conspired to murder her husband, Romanos. And after the alleged assassination of Romanos, Michael and Zoe married the same day. And a day later, Michael was crowned emperor. Now, this is an illustrated manuscript of the assassination of Romanos III. But take a good look at all the characters in this manuscript. As you can see, they all have that dark, smudged, greyish tint to their pigmentation. But take a look at Romanos himself, the dude that is being strangled. Look how dark grey he is. Brothers, if he was to take a tub of black paint and add a tub of white paint to that black paint, it's going to come out grey. These people always use, obviously, some type of whitenized chemical solution to try to scrub the black or colour off of these images. This is why you always see them come out in a dark, greyish, fadish colour. But even if he was to go on the narrative, it got dark over time once again. Why does the darkening effect always affect skin pigmentation, but nowhere else on said image? Here's another manuscript titled The Widow Aldi Visits Emperor Romanos III. Brothers, these are two icons which I know I'm going to 100% completely pronounce their names wrong, but to the left is ruler Drad Brankovic, and to the right is his wife Irene Katakonaj, I think that's how you pronounce it, of Serbia. This is an icon of their daughter Mara Brankovic. This is a portrait of Stephen the First of Hungary sitting on his throne. Stephen was the last Grand Prince of the Hungarians between the years 997 and 1000, and was the first King of Hungary from 1000 until his death in 1038. So now we're going to take a look at some facial reconstructions of what the original Eastern Europeans looked like, which pretty much translates to all of Europe also, as well as some portraits. So this is from the Real History, WW, and the little excerpt at the bottom, it reads, "The first European bust created from modern human remains found at Pestra Qoase." I already know I completely pronounced that wrong, but that translates to cave with bones. Romania, circa 35,000 BC. So to the left, Kostenkiman, Ukraine, Russia, 34,000 BC, bust created by Professor M. Gerasimov. To the right, Sungir Man, hey, don't hate on my Russian pronunciations. Vladimir, Russia, 26,000 BC. The Combi Capelliman, an ancestor of some European nations, restored according to the directions of Professor Rutot of Brussels. So these two profile pictures here, at the bottom it reads, "This black man is a descendant of the original black settlers of the far north, such as the Serbian, Malta, and Russian Sungir people, circa 25,000. Now the title of this portrait reads, "Frontal and Profile Views of a Laplander, Anthropological Study by Expedition of Prince Roland Bonaparte, 1884, printed circa 1886. Sitter's name, that's the dude in the photo, is named Anders Andersen Anso. The photographs are housed in the Norsk Folk Museum, Norway." Portrait of a black Abkhazian tribesman, circa 1800s. Now for those who don't know, Abkhazia is in Georgia. Here's two more portraits of black Abkhazians. To the left, at the bottom it reads, "A black Abkhazian named Renhi, who lives in the village of Adziyobza." To the right, at the bottom it reads, "A black Abkhazian warrior." So I thought I would add this, since we saw some facial reconstructions of the original Europeans. So some of you may already know this. The title, it reads, "Cheddar Man, Discovery, First Modern Britain Had Dark Skin," is a reminder we are all from Africa, expert says. Now I love how they gave the Cheddar Man blue eyes, because that's them trying to inject themselves into history. Because when you think of blue eyes, you think of so-called white people. Now don't get it twisted, it doesn't mean that so-called black people can't have blue eyes, because all blue eyes are is a recessive trait. It's just basically a loss of pigmentation or a loss of melanin in the iris. But I just want to go into their pseudoscience. I'm sure you guys have heard before, they say things like, the reason why people have quote-unquote fair skin, it's because they live in cold environments. Brothers, if you was to take the darkest Hermetic people from the Horn of Africa and place them in Iceland, over the course of time, over thousands of years, those Hermetic people are still going to be very dark in complexion. It doesn't matter about what environment they live in. But they have to come up with a lot of that evolutionary nonsense once again to inject themselves into history. So this is from the book Nature Knows No Color Line by J.A. Rogers. And you can find this on archive.org. Now we are going to read this excerpt since it mentions Russia. So Negroes in ancient Europe and Greece. A very singular fact about color prejudice, where you would expect to find it the most, it is least, namely in Europe, homeland of the whites. Now we all know that's not the original homeland. So-called black people are the original civilizers and builders of Europe. But of course this was published in 1950, and by that time period, the Caucasian was in rulership. So this is true of the most ancient times to the present. And contrary to popular belief, as I should show, Negroes were in certain areas abundant. Moreover, whites, especially of the upper classes, were fascinated by them. There was a great vogue, a fad, for having them about long before the Christian era and down to the middle of the 19th century. Most royal and noble palaces from Sicily to northern Russia had them. Tall, coal black Negroes of magnificent physique were a feature of the palaces of the Tsars as late as 1917. Now people, this is an icon of Stephen the Great, or Stephen the Third of Moldavia. Now he was Prince of Moldavia from 1457 to 1504, and he was the founder of the Voronezh Monastery. Why is that important? Brothers, speaking of the Voronezh Monastery, we are going to take a look at a very interesting fresco. This is the full version of the fresco at the Voronezh Monastery in Bukovina, Romania, and it's titled The Last Judgment. So what we're going to do, we're going to take a look at some zooming still shots and analyze these images. So this zoom in is at the top of the fresco, and as you can see, it's Yahawashi with the angels, and they all have dark skin complexion. But take a good look at Yahawashi himself. You can see he's rocking the afro. And for those of you that are new, when I say Yahawashi, I'm speaking about Christ. Here's another zoom in. As you can see, they're all dark skinned. You see the two angels and the dude holding the cross. I think that's the penitent thief. I'm not too sure. But point being, they're all dark skinned. Another still shot close up, which looks like it's depicting a bunch of saints. Now take a very, very, very close look at this close up here. As you guys can see, there is a certain demographic of people being rounded up with demons. They're in chains, and they're being led into captivity by the angels. I'm going to not say anything for about 10 seconds, and I want you guys to take a very good look at this. Our people, Bin, knew who these people were. For those of you guys that read the scriptures, we know what's going to happen to certain demographics in the end. But like the brother J2K also pointed out, you can also use this as a backdrop to link back to when these people went into captivity for 1,000 years. So for those of you that have seen multiple of my videos, you've probably heard me say that our people gained back dominion in the early 100 AD period, and they kept a certain demographic as slaves, as servants, as Slavs, and for those that they didn't kept as slaves, they drove them back to the edge of the world, to the forest, to the woods, and to the Caucasus Mountains. And this demographic of people were shut off from civilization, and they delved into a beast-like state known as the Wild Man. They grew excessive body hair, and they walked around on all fours. Right? So now we're going to get Revelations 20. But before we get to that, you guys might be asking to yourself, KMZ, why do you keep saying this demographic of people? We can clearly see who these people are. What you guys have to understand, you have to understand the YouTube platform that this video is going to be uploaded to. And because of the nature of the topic that we are on now, it can be seen as quote unquote hate speech. And you know what happens when they consider things hate speech? Videos go missing, channels go missing. So this is why I have to use certain verbiage when I delve into certain topics. So Revelations 20, and I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. So what is the bottomless pit? The bottomless pit is the back of the Caucasus, the rocks, the mountains, and the caves. It's literal pits, the depths of the earth. So verse 2, and he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. So what is that bound him 1,000 years? This is where he had no dominion, no rulership, no societies. Our people put him into servitude. This is why he likes to call it the Dark Ages, because that is the time period where he was chased back to the Caucasus Mountains and in the forest. Verse 3, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till the 1,000 years shall be fulfilled, and after that he must be loosed a little season. So what is that little season? This is where he re-emerged back into mainland Europe, and he brought a lot of the plagues and diseases that wiped out a large majority of the black population in Europe. Now, of course, he didn't gain dominion overnight when he was loosened a little season. Of course, this is where you start to have Renaissance and whitewashing, but our people were still in rulership. Over the course of 100 years, prior to him being loosened, he gained dominion around the early 1900s. And from then, he's still in rulership. This is why I tell you guys that Esau is going to be in rulership before Yahawashi returns. Some of you may ask, so how the heck did these people manage to gain rulership over our people when they were living in caves and living in the forest? Well, now you have the spiritual element to that. So the definition of the bottomless pit in the blue letter Bible. So bottomless, unbounded, the abyss, the pit, the immeasurable depth of Orcus, a very deep gulf or chasm in the lowest parts of the earth, used as the common receptacle of the dead, and especially as the abode of demons. Now, didn't we just read that the devil was cast into the bottomless pit? Because that's where his abode is. So going back to this fresco, we can see that this demographic of people, they have red hair. So now we're going to take a look at an article that the brother Peter the Great linked. On National Redhead Day, explore the history of ginger Jews. As any self-respecting redhead would tell you, it's not just hair color, it's a lifestyle. But we didn't always live in a world of redhead reunions and Spitfire portrait series. For centuries, red hair was feared and reviled, especially when it came to Europe's Jews. In honor of National Redhead Day, we've outlined the tenuous connection between Jews and the dissembling color. It goes way back. The Hebrew Bible refers to both Esau and David as Admoni. Now you already know what they're going to try and do. They're going to try and say that David was pale with red rosy cheeks. When ruddy is used for David, it's talking about a brown complexion with a red undertone. I've already made videos on this. Just type in red or ruddy earth. Type in ruddy and any animal next to it, like a ruddy duck, a ruddy cow, a ruddy dog, a ruddy cat, and it's always going to show a brown, reddish complexion. But if you type in ruddy people, it's going to show you pale people with red rosy cheeks. So what's going on? But most of you guys should already know what ruddy means by now. So, a word that can refer to red hair or a ruddy complexion. But it seems unlikely that this physical descriptor comes with any moral undertones. Esau, the Torah's most famous dupe, is cheated out of his inheritance by younger brother Jacob. No, Esau sold his birthright. Hebrews 12 and 16. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. While David slays Goliath and goes on to becoming king of his people, these two redheads don't have much in common. Hey, you can say that again. David was not red rosy cheeks or pale with red rosy cheeks and had red hair. He was a so-called black man. So now we're just going to skip down and get to the meat of the article. So Eastern European Jews reclaim the red. Some medieval Germans believe that the Caucasus Mountains were inhabited by Die Rote Juden, or the Red Jews. Fearsome red-headed tribes collaborating with the Antichrist to destroy Christian societies. This myth probably refers to the Khazars, a nomadic Central Asian tribe that did convert to Judaism before dying out in the 10th century. These Jewish boogeymen took the blame for catastrophes like the Black Plague, which they supposedly caused by providing the European Jewish brethren with poison to slip into Christian wells. But I'm glad that this has been debunked though, because why would you blame a group of people for causing the Black Death? Right, guys? So this book is called The Wild Man, Medieval Myth and Symbolism. Now, whenever I mention in my videos that the wild man was walking on all fours, he had intercourse with animals, he ate dead flesh, he was a cannibal, you guys probably think I'm making these things up to make the wild man seem much worse than he actually is. Well, now we're going to read some historical documentation on the wild man and some of his characteristics and his dwelling places. By every account, the wild man's behavior matched his primitive surroundings. Strong enough to uproot trees, he was violent and aggressive, not only against wild animals, but also against his own kind. His brutish, contentious nature expressed itself in a natural combativeness against which neither beast nor man was equal. Though his club and sometimes only his bare hands was his only weapon, with his instinctive knowledge of the ways of the wild beast, the wild man was a skilled hunter. Now, wasn't Esau also known as a skilled hunter? That was the only redeeming quality about him. He was good at hunting. But, in spite of his physical supremacy, shrank from contact with humans and frequently even with his own kind. Indeed, his inept social abilities apparently limited him to only that cooperative union required for procreation. Lacking agriculture, he was forced to eke out a substance from hunting and gathering, thought to crawl around on all fours. He scratched tubers and roots from the ground, picked berries and gnawed on verdure. When he killed game, he ate it completely raw. According to Chrétien de Troyes in Yavin, by many accounts, the wild man also indulged in cannibalism. By the 16th century, this habit brought him to association with werewolves and other flesh eaters. Wild men were commonly thought to abduct children, but often only to fulfill parental instincts. Instances of wild folk substituting changelings for human children are also recorded. Although he was a hunter, the wild man was frequently hunted. Illustrations of the 14th century depict the wild man on all fours at bay, pursued by hounds and hunters on horseback. Incapable of speech, the wild man muttered only unintelligible sounds, or none at all. You see, he was in such a base state. Thought to live in remote mountainous and forested regions. Let's run that back. Thought to live in remote mountainous and forested regions. The wild man especially flourished in the wooded or alpine regions of the German speaking lands, such as Harzwitzel and Allgäu mountains of Germany. The alpine regions of Carinthia and the Tyrol in Austria, and the Graubünden, I know completely butchered that, and Wallis in Switzerland. You guys are gonna have to forgive me on my pronunciation on these names. So, in many such areas, the myths have survived to this day, still celebrated in festivals, masquerades, and dramas. Not limited to these regions, however, the wild man myth thrived throughout Western and Central Europe. In these forests, the wild man was said to make his home in caves, rocky crags, dank burrows, hollows in tree trunks, and other rude places. Occasionally, he fashioned primitive hovels of branches and mud. An 11th century Hessian document refers to such as an abode as Wildro Weibu Hus, Wild Woman's House. Toward the end of the 14th century, Heinrich von Hessler states in Die Apocalypse that the wild man lived only in places unfit for human habitation. Let's run that back. The wild man lived only in places unfit for human habitation, in fens and woods, in water and in mountains, in caves and in bushes. He was cast to the bottomless pit, and this is why he calls it the Dark Ages. Now, the Dark Ages has a double meaning, because Dark Ages also symbolizes dark people in rulership, but it also symbolizes him in darkness, because he was shut off from civilization. And as you can see, he lived in rocks, he lived in caves, he lived in mountainous regions, and he lived in the woods. He delved into his beast-like state known as the wild man. He had no written language, didn't bathe, didn't shower, didn't clean himself, harbored all type of body lice and fleas. This was him during the Middle Ages, people. He was not the Vikings, he was not the Celts, he was not the Scottish clans, he was not the Gauls, he was not the Norsemen, he was not the Danes. He was not the king, he was not the prince, he was not the lords, he was not the barons, he was not the dukes. That was our people. Hopefully that was an edifying lesson for you, brothers and sisters. With that being said, giving all praises to the Most High Yahweh, in the name of Yahweh Shai.